Well, this video did really well, so why not continue with Sonic stuff? Yeah, why not? Welcome back. I think it's safe to say that this channel will most likely be cemented towards Sega's icon for the future to come. Literally all of my Sonic-related videos have outperformed everything else I've mustered over this past year.
Oh gosh!
So it's safe to say that this place is where I'm appealing to most. Well, glad to have found a digital home, I guess. That's not to say I won't make other stuff in the future. If Grand Theft Auto 6 ever gets released, I will cover that ASAP. I've got my eye on the film Free Guy. I might make an odd video on something off topic. Who knows? Only time will tell. But for now, allow me to reminisce about a game that is unhealthily too close to my heart. The 2010 title Sonic Colors. So this game sort of gets labelled as the game that won the fans back, and often considered an unimportant game in the grand scheme of things that was only just enough for people to trust Sega again after the crash and burn that were the mid-2000s. Once Unleashed came out, people still weren't sold on the whole transformation aspect and wasn't exactly warmly received at first. Despite the fact that it featured completely new and original courses never seen before, gave intricate insight to the world and its history, had one of the greatest theme songs in franchise history and was actually good. Yeah, that got completely overlooked on release. But it was enough to start slightly turning heads again, and Colors would have to be the game to prove that Sega actually knew what they're doing. And this time, Colors did impress. To an extent. Its much more basic plot and gameplay approach demonstrated to consumers that Sega do remember how to make good 3D and 2D platformers. But that's it. At the time, it garnered not much other additional praise from the fans. It was just okay in their eyes. But me? Well, I'm stubborn enough to look back at this era in a different eye. Colors was the first proper Sonic title I ever played, swiftly followed by Unleashed. So I might oversell points a bit too much, but at the same time, I grew up playing all the DS games from my last video and thought that all of them were great when I was younger, so I think my critical eyes opened up a bit. Just a little bit. So then, without wasting any more time, let's just pop this disc in and see what we get from this. I cannot describe the immense amount of sheer nostalgia that erupted inside of me when I heard that theme song again after all these years. We open with a fantastic opening cinematic, not giving backstory that could easily be skipped on accident like with Unleashed, but just a pure cutscene of what hijinks you can expect to come. It's also worth noting that this is the last game in the series that opens up with a cinematic. You don't wait for it to appear after a few seconds of waiting on the opening title card like with Lost World or Mania, it just starts immediately and it is glorious. And then we get the menu screen, another couple of magnificent pieces of music to welcome us in. The first very noticeable thing about Colors is the score, which is sublime. I don't think there is one piece of music that I genuinely don't like in this soundtrack. They're all great at reflecting the zones or levels they're for, and this is probably because Sega managed to score big time by getting Cash Cash to work on the music alongside Sega's music department. Cash Cash. A group that actually makes really good electronic music and is behind some of my personal favourite pieces. How did it all go so wrong from here? The one theme that I think perfectly, and I mean perfectly, reflects its location is Planet Wisp, but we'll get into that place in a bit. For now, let us get into the meat of this game, starting off with Tropical Resort. As soon as you load in, you're thrown right into the heart of a bustling theme park center strewn with color, noise, and liveliness, and you're free to roam around. But before I start talking about the stages and the plot that goes along with it, I will comment on a couple of other general points about this title, starting with the gameplay, which was clearly not made with the Wiimote in mind. Since Sonic is primarily a console release game series, it functions best with Xbox or PlayStation controllers. Now, you see, Nintendo decided, you know what? We just finished snorting another line, let's make our brand spanking new console's controller a fucking TV remote. As a result, you've got a very different way of controlling whatever goes on the screen. The joystick is no longer there, replaced with the classic northeast-southwest gamepad instead. The right-hand button count has been halved and goes in numbers now, the A button is used by 50% of the games in the Wii's library, the B button acts as a singular version of the trigger buttons, this controller is inducing a migraine as we speak. Bottom line is, the Wiimote isn't an ideal pick. You have to hold it sideways like the other console counterparts, and it doesn't feel as normal as a result. As for controls, they're surprisingly decent for the Wiimote. Turning left and right is pretty good, but takes a little bit of skill to master. You're bound to accidentally drift off here and there, so you've got to learn this new system, so that's nice. The jumping is decent, it's not as good as the jumping mechanics were in Generations, but it'll do. And the double jump. Oh shit, it's like Forces all over again. The double jump in colours has a similar problem to the one present in Forces, as it gives you another small increase of height instead of a small boost forward. However, I can give colours a pass here. Only just, okay? It's not bias, right? Just shut up. Okay, maybe a little bit. There are two big differences between both iterations of the double jump. One, you actually get a noticeable extra jump out of the one in colours, and two, you don't have to sacrifice your horizontal velocity much to pull it off. So it's actually useful in colours. Halla fucking you, yeah. And thankfully, unlike every other Wii port in the franchise, you don't have to tangle with motion controls this time around. Pretty good all around, but the Wiimote does still feel a bit weird to hold sideways and take some getting used to. Other than that, they're fine. Just the bare minimum of controls to make a competent entry. So with these controls, we get to venture through Tropical Resort, and what an opening level it is. Coincidentally, this is also the last in-canon game that doesn't start in Green Hill or some variant of Green Hill. Colours really was the last straw before the collapse of the 2010s. This place feels alive. We got traffic on the nebula in the sky, pathways that lead to shops and attractions, views of the galaxy above. This is a beautiful setting for such a small-scale game, leading into my next general overview, which is the atmosphere surrounding this game. I'm not sure how to describe it, but this title in particular features the strongest atmospheres of any Sonic levels I've ever seen before. Each location is dripping with sensations, sounds, landscapes, none of which have been rivaled since. Quite a bold statement to make, I know, but if you don't believe me, try it out for yourself. You may be on vast new planets teeming with life on some and industry on others, but the looming feeling of space is always right behind you. That sense of being a minuscule being in the midst of a gargantuan universe never leaves the back of your head, which really helps boost immersion. And what creates this effect? In my opinion, it's the lighting system. Now make no mistake, the tonal depth of the lights are very safe and take no serious risks. Shadows really aren't definitive, and the overall saturation remains very consistent throughout the course of levels and rarely changes. Yet somewhere in the simplicity, an unmatched feeling is created. Since the lighting takes on a more high-key, low-contrast style, it depends on the overall colour of the environment to bleed into the saturation and depict a colour onto your screen. And somehow, it works. The bright pink and yellow sources in Sweet Mountain create a sweet treat of an aesthetic. Eh? Eh? No. The distinguished navy blue and hints of crimson red in the aquarium park sell the aquatic setting immaculately. The strongly contrasting rays of black against white in Starlight Carnival, mixed with the slight rainbows with the primary light blue hue, create a stunning environment that has unfortunately never been revisited. And if we could have a more stark range of depth and tone in the shadows, then we would have a home run of a sensation that would be, dare I say, perfect. And I'll plug this in now, but please, Sega, for God's sake, pour over colours onto PC. Like, why not? It would be awesome. Maybe a remaster with updated graphics and a lighting system, a little bit like the one in Forces. And why not Unleash too? And how about Heroes? Maybe throw in Rush as well. So, we've gone through the first level. It's bustling and drenched in atmosphere from the moody lighting, golden hue and upbeat soundtrack. It's also got good level design, teaching players how to jump, boost, home attack, platform, double jump, pretty good overall. And then we get our first cutscene that isn't pre-rendered, and you can tell, uses the same engine from the gameplay. But at least that means the atmosphere stays. And we get our first look at the characters. And I have a bit of a problem with it. The cast of characters in Colours is also significantly small scale, featuring only 5 characters. Or 6 if you want to be pedantic. And the dialogue exchanges in general are less than fantastic. Listen, I adore Colours, it's without question one of the best games I own on the Wii, but the dialogue, delivery and comedy isn't as strong as the score or scenery. But at the same time, I understand why. This was the debut game for Roger Craig Smith to do the role of Sonic, previously done by Jason Griffith. Now, Jason wasn't a bad voice actor, the era of games he got was unfortunate to say the least, but alongside that he carried over that sort of stereotypically over-the-top nasal kind of American accent. You know the one. In the late 2000s, this was universally recognised as being the Hedgehog's voice, still on that edgy side of the coin. While this effect did noticeably start fading off a bit by the time Unleashed came out, it was still present. Then 2010 rolls around, and Roger is up. You can tell that he was trying that distinct touch, but the problem is, Roger's voice sounds too matured for that type of accent to work.
Because Eggman plus secretly built amusement park equals evil plot for us to foil. Lucky for us, he's not very good at keeping things hidden.
It makes him feel more like a caricature than an actual character, and that takes away from the weight of the plot. Thankfully, in modern times, this has been realised, and in my honest opinion, Roger's best performances were done in the Boom TV series on Cartoon Network. That show didn't take itself seriously at all, and as a result, you've got creative episodes that just ooze with character and flair.
So, you really don't remember anything? Not even those twins?
Oh, I remember the twins, alright. I mean, I remember how much I disliked them.
Sonic's voice, egomaniacal personality, and dialect are fucking perfect. And the show and its art style has grown on me, and it's honestly spot on. I'm hoping more stuff comes from this in the future. But unfortunately, this isn't the late 2010s. This is 2010. And you can just tell in the voice that this was more of an emulation than a fresh take. The nasal accent is there, but the dialect from Sonic doesn't match. And I feel like even the writers knew that this was going to be a completely new iteration, and this reflects in dialogue, which is still exposition stuff, but features some unique haha moments, which really make you LOL, yes?
They're either being used for their magical powers by an evil man, or to make underwear to be worn by Sally.
Yeah, that was really, really cracking humor right there. Your mum. The comedy that comes from every character in this game feels very hit or miss, with it more often than not missing the mark. It has fourth wall breaks and dry humor, but not as in Boom levels of dry, but rather more charismatic in its approach. It was a new era, they were still trying to find their feet, I accept that. But it doesn't take away from the fact that this is cringe. But that's just Sonic. How about Tails? Same as ever. Except now he's making the beta version of Duolingo on his iPad. And the Eggmeister? Well, seems a bit more toned down in his antics with this title. Orbot and Cubot are making their first appearance here though, so that's something I guess. And then there are the Wisps. Hardly characters, so they don't count, sue me. So the cutscenes in general, not fantastic unfortunately. But what actually happens in these cutscenes? Well, the story, of course. The plot is what makes Colors a much smaller scale game, as it's very short and linear. In a nutshell, Baldy McNosehair, as he's now nicknamed. Oh god, we're going into that type of territory. Yeah, anyway, he's managed to create a park in space filled with attractions, restaurants, shops, views, planets. What an altruistic act. Perhaps we treated him too harshly and he's gone and enslaved the whole race of alien creatures. Wow, what a fucking buzzkill. Whilst other games have had themes going against the government and the military in the past, this title just dives headfirst into the enslavement theme. Now, before you mention it, yes, I know. Robotnik's schemes always involve capturing animals to be turned into robots, but they literally mention in Colors that he's not just turning Wisps into robots, he's forcing them to generate energy for the park, essentially forced labor. But holy shit, that's a bit heavy-handed, don't you think? Christ. So yeah, this magical Disneyland is actually fueled by underpaid employees that get forced to work against their wills. So, better hop off and rescue them off your pot. After you make your way through the tropical resort, you get another hysterical exchange and face off against a Cyclops from Cyberpunk. You got some rotating platforms to reach the thing's eye and whack it a couple times like a fly swatter. Pretty entertaining boss fight, yet offers little in terms of a challenge. Also, just using a laser wisp basically assures you that this oversized claw machine stays dead. So far, so good. Great setting, gameplay and atmosphere, but has a weaker script. So, what's next for Colors? Well, the choice is yours. Two new locations open up upon completing Tropical Resort, the Sweet Mountain and the Starlight Carnival. Let's start with the Cookie Creek. This zone feels really quite out of place when compared to the rest of the locations at your disposal. I'd say that it has the weakest atmosphere present in the whole game, but that doesn't mean there's no atmosphere. It's still here and alive. We're thrown down into Paul Hollywood's kitchen and are presented with much more intuitive 3D platforming challenges here. There are rockets to avoid, shooting out some cereal in its exhaust, enemies wear chef hats and wield spatulas, as you do. The cartoonish aesthetic sells this place really effectively. Either that, or Sonic took too much fentanyl before coming to this place. We're also introduced to the Drill Wisp here, allowing you to burrow underground and would later be copied by every subsequent fucking 3D Sonic game in the series. Which reminds me, the Wisps and what they can do. Each planet has a unique Wisp that allows you to gain certain abilities. Tropical Resort has the Laser Wisp, allowing you to zip into DMs in an instant. Very useful indeed. Sweet Mountain has the Drill, already discussed this. Starlight Carnival introduces the Cube, a TV show where contestants have to... Oh shit, hang on, this is the wrong script. It allows you to change these, whatever you call them, into solid surfaces and vice versa for a limited amount of time. So on, so on. It's honestly surprising seeing how many aspects of Colors would later be recycled to fund the modern era. The Color Wisps would appear in every 3D title, music has been reused, Baldy McNose hair would stick way too long for its own good. Can this game get some actual fucking praise for God's sake? After you get through Acid Land and the syringes in certain level, holy shit, was Sonic actually high in these stages? Bloody hell. You meet the second boss fight, atop a ship floating on a sea of coke, I'm presuming. But this boss is actually low-key really fun. You see, you start by being aboard the rig and homing attacking your way past the cookie dough cannonballs to flip the off switch to the vessel, a very smart design decision. You then leap off onto the meth ground and fight the captain head on. But to avoid this portion being stale, repetitive and boring, the captain's got a crew on board and they can be jumping for joy. You could say that they make this fight annoying, but I say shut your gob, we're gaming here. Defeating these mini enemies actually refills the boost gauge, and when the captain's on the ground bellowing his lungs out, boosting into him does a good chunk of damage. Once you get him once, back on the ship, repeat a second time. Except this time when you get off the thing, he's recruited the entire population of Nassau to protect him, thus making it harder to land a hit. Overall, I think Edward Kenway would be proud. Now, let us move on to Starlight Carnival. This level wastes no time in presenting its identity and pizzazz. You're immediately turned upside down and sprint out into a clustered march of ships equipped in neon doing whatever while you spiral around, on top and inside of them. Meanwhile, you've got the 80s booming through your speakers as you venture through this location. This level is fully aware of the looming feeling of space encasing this game and uses that to make this place feel like the center of a grand cosmos. Vessels are coming out of black holes, portals, whatever those are. The camera does a dolly roll towards the end, the ladybugs race on a bloody rainbow path. This might as well be a cyberpunk Asgard. In other stages in this zone, platforming is a big focus. There's a maze-like place inside the ship, a place where you utilize a hover wisp to go up and up and up. I'm using this three-point structure of sentence way too much, I'm sorry, I'll stop. But it's all here, with that light blue hue softly adding the finishing touch as discussed earlier. What's the boss like in this stage? Another creative new one. Alright, we're 3 for 3, Colors is on a roll. This time, one of the many ships has gone sentient and requires a technical team to fix. Or rather, to be banged up, because that's the same thing. You avoid laser strikes and crates of spikes while trying to land aggressive button mashes onto key components of the rig. You even go into 2D segments to dodge and attack the old-fashioned way. Another top quality boss, followed by a cutscene. In said cutscene, Tails has at long last gotten the Duolingo app set up and has gotten a rough translation of the Wisp's language. Here's what they had to say.
Here's a world map. Now here's the text. Shut the fuck up. That's what you should do.
Okay, no, I can't keep that up. This one, who's called Yakka, yeah, fitting name, says that 5 tractor beams are set up connecting 5 planets back to Tropical Resort. Better make like Americans and liberate the colonies, Sonic. Wait a minute. But not before Tails says the most intelligent sentence known to man.
But still, yeah.
Okay, fine. 5 generators? Well, I've already leveled 2.
So, if my math is correct, that leaves us 3 more of those bad boys to take out.
Alas, 3 more areas have opened up, and this is where the game starts to slow down a little bit. These areas are all still great, it's just that the narrative and general layout start to lose steam. Don't believe me? Alright, boss battles. These 3 locations now reuse the same battles that were done in Tropical Resort, Sweet Mountain and Starlight Carnival, with slight variations on them. The only one that distinctly stands out is the boss in Aquarium Park, which is the same as Sweet Mountains, just taking place in the Pacific this time around, which is oh so fun. So why don't we start these levels off with the Aquarium Park, eh? As mentioned before, the park has a very strong navy blue hue to it, with dashes of red cropping up here and there. And once again, the atmosphere is spot on with a Chinese architectural style and music reflecting this, mixed with an echoing piano reinforcing the fact that you're in a massive scale aquarium with tanks that echo as well. That sounded better in my head, hang on. What I mean is, it makes you feel more encased in a large area. Okay, never mind, I can't BS my way out of this one. Nevertheless, it's good. You even got segments where you wander into the cobblestone pathways and streams. It's a really great atmosphere. So, what happened? Well, it's an aquarium. I wonder what natural element will be commonplace here. To be fair though, Colors did try to spice things up just a bit. Spamming jump makes Sonic spin and begin rising to the surface, so all that tosh of, oh, he can't swim, has gone out the fucking window. He's a deep sea diver now, deal with it. These underwater segments seem more like mazes in some areas. There are several routes that you could take with lots of twists and turns that would make anyone seasick, even featuring the drill wisp here to turn you into a submarine, and of course it features some aquatic life as standard. To be honest, it's quite frankly terrifying how deep you can go in some levels. The water gets real dark and the new drowning theme has taken a bite out of Jaws' musical suspense. Again. Okay, fine, I'll stop. Then there's the boss. Underwater. Whoop-dee-doo. Aquarium Park isn't a horrible zone. The atmosphere is once again spot on, but I don't know. Water levels in general aren't really my thing. How about that? I actually said something negative about colours. Hey, this recolored unoriginal hedgehog in a hoodie has fucking character development. Hey! Now the next zone. The one that I've really wanted to talk about up until this point is finally here. May I present to you Planet Wisp. Planet Wisp is a magical place, it truly is. The stark contrast that it represents is something to behold. You see, Planet Wisp is sort of like the safe haven for all the free wisps that haven't been captured, but at the same time, Eggman has begun laying the foundations of another location like Tropical Resort or Aquarium Park. It's in the throes of renovation and it just gets you thinking. All those beautiful locations, all those vistas and atmospheres, they're artificial. They were all colonized by Eggman and transformed from what they were. Planet Wisp is just the last place to conquer, and it's undergoing that transfer. I think it's safe to say that there hasn't quite been another level that has so much going on contextually in it at once. I mean, for goodness sake, the Wisps are losing their last hope of freedom here, and these machines are representative of the modern world taking over nature. Okay, I'm going in too deep here. Point is, this location actually feels more realistic as we can physically see the conflicting settings clash. It's effective. Like, really effective. Along with this theme, the hue and music make it infinitely more powerful. Since you're on a planet that was originally just pure nature, there is a brighter feel to open areas with a pale green saturation. And since the primary colour scheme, the industrial segments are prominently orange or rusty brown, they seem really out of place, conveying the whole mise-en-scene more effectively. And the soundtrack can't be described with words alone. The piano reflecting the innocence of the place and guitars symbolizing the urbanization just make the whole piece come together. Perfection. Okay, that was too detailed. The wisps, right then. So in this place you also utilize the spike wisp, allowing you to roll alongside walls and ceilings, once again creating more diverse gameplay. But unfortunately, this wisp doesn't prioritize speed like the laser, but rather creating new paths and platforming. And Planet Wisp certainly adores platforming. The only times where you actually start running at considerable speeds are in very brief sequences. Then you're thrown back into a skyscraper to somersault your way to the top again. This, unfortunately, makes some of Planet Wisp's stages feel too slow and a chore to get through. There are no real sections where you're just purely exposed to the natural environment, there's always a reminder of industry at the next turn. Generations actually improved upon this as you start the 3D level in the heart of the dense vegetation, and purple water. Okay, was Sonic overdosing on something back at Sweet Mountain? Seriously, man. And after you get a feel for what the environment is like, you then enter the industrial section, giving us a broader overview of this planet. Unfortunately, colors didn't think of this, and the industrial theming is too prominent. So, is Planet Wisp actually perfect? No, not really. But what about the boss? This is the worst part about the location. As mentioned before, the bosses after you complete the first half of the game are copy-pasted from the beginning as well, and Planet Wisps is practically the same as Tropical Resorts, just coloured green as a trade-off, severely underwhelming as a finisher for such a creative place. But oh well, we got one last key location. Make it count. Asteroid Coaster. So while Sonic overdosed on some illegal drugs back in the Sweet Mountain, he took one too many Red Bulls and can now only see monster energy on this planet. It's tragic, really. One like equals one prayer. Seriously, this course to me just feels like the developers said, fuck it. We got all the best stuff out, let's put them on a crazy level with heavy metal and wrap this thing up. We got Super Monkey Ball 3D to develop.
Get your shit together!
So while all the previous levels had general themes and consistent layouts, this place is an amalgamation of everything crazy that was left out. You got roller coasters and the Frenzy Wisp turning Sonic into your average bloodhound from Manchester, and also the center for where the Wisp's energy is also harvested for Eggman. Wow, okay, they really wanted to go out with a bang. The atmosphere in this zone is similar to that of Starlight Carnival, as you are literally in space on a planet with no apparent stratosphere. As a result, the hue is very dark, but is given a more sinister tone with the powerful green and purple lights emitting from the canisters and water. So, what happens in this place? Well, you got some more emphasis on speed this time, thank God for that, but you also do a bit of meteor hopping and moon hopping. Christ. And being the place where all the energy for the park is stored, you're of course prompted to wreck shit up. What that leaves you with is a chaotic, nonsensical environment where there are no rules. It's a pretty great area, but doesn't offer anything of much significance other than that. So the boss? Yeah, taking a leaf out of Starlight Carnival's spark as well. Same boss, slightly harder difficulty, bang bang pop, rings, Michael Bay explosion, here's your rank. So that's all the stages. Okay, the game's not that linear. This ain't Sonic 4. So after defeating all the bosses, we of course assume we won. But cut back to Eggman, and he is planning to repeat the, Adventure 2 piss cannon maneuver.
How do you like that, Obama?
But unfortunately for him, there's a leak in one of the, I'm presuming, energy fuel tanks. And you may be thinking, oh, well, that's very artificially introduced at the last minute. What is this, Deus Ex Machina? Well, cool your jets, mate, because this leakage was established earlier on in a cutscene after completing Tropical Resort. So suck it, colours did good. Though they could have reinforced this plot point again at some point, but let me have this win, I love this game, shut up. So the leakage causes the cannon to backfire and collapse upon itself, creating a black hole, Shadow Mewtwo Photon Blast, something big and black and nasty that devours matter itself. Even Eggman's taken back by this and then bails. Cut back to Sonic, he's decided that he has officially smoked too much crack in this joint and heads for the terminal velocity. The final zone consisting of 2.5 levels. First one has you sprinting down the ship from Interstellar while avoiding a wide range of enemies. This place doesn't really have much of an atmosphere compared to other stages, since it's just a chrome white beam stranded in the middle of the sky, but I don't really count this as a proper stage. There are no red rings or anything, just a rank at the end. It really just serves as filler and is only used to introduce us to where the final boss will be. Speaking of, the final boss is some amalgamation of wisps and is quite a behemoth to look at. So after Sonic pulls a Kazuma Kiryu, it's now just him and the nose hair wacky slapstick joke. You combat this Meta Knight halberd on a disc surrounding the beam you ran down before, but this final fight actually has an atmosphere this time round. Since this platform is in between Earth and the park, you're positioned in a way that you can't see either, leaving the bare night sky as a backdrop and that distinct looming thought of space is now staring you in the eyes. As for combating against this adversary, we haven't got a recycled boss from any previous zones, thankfully. Original challenges to avoid and overcome. Well, I say original lightly. You go up against a good few of the color abilities now wielded by Eggman and is a solid callback. And once you find an opening, you can deal some serious damage if you do a homing attack fast enough. Yet there isn't the same amount of challenge like in Adventure 2's climax or Unleashed, where you had to carefully conserve your ring count. It's sort of just dodge the small attack bursts and wait for an obvious opening to appear. Ah well, the music is an excellent redeeming quality, as always, goddamn. I don't know how they do it, but every game's final boss theme, thereabouts. Most of the series' final boss themes are all tremendous touches that add so much more to the experience. Sonic Forces, while I didn't enjoy the story, gameplay or conflicted theming, had a pretty great climax and the music was spot on again for keeping to the general vibe of other songs in the soundtrack and emulating them into one single finishing piece. Unleashed had a roaring orchestra that fitted in perfectly to the stakes of the situation. Lost Worlds was a crazy and chaotic orchestra x rock track that symbolizes the more outlandish nature of the game. And the same remains true for Colors. It begins with an orchestra, again, but eventually fades into a much more dramatic version of Reach for the Stars with a distant violin performing the signature tune. I love this so much. So, you defeated Eggman, the main antagonist, his ship exploded into confetti, we're all done here, yes? Well, no. There's still Shadow Mewtwo's big black ball of death coming at you, so you still gotta get the fuck off this beam and back to Earth. So, one last final stage. Except not really, it's not a traditional stage again, not even a rank at the end of it. So, you attempt to outrun the final smash, but not quick enough. And we enter the last pre-rendered cutscene in the whole series. And, Sonic gets eliminated from the SoCal tournament. And actually, I just realized, why did Sega try to kill Sonic off in the late 2000s? Every single game would end with him barely just clinging onto life. And come to think of it, he's directly quoted from the Black Knight saying that every world has its end and that's why we gotta live life to the fullest in the time we have. Mate, was Sega indirectly trying to buy out of the IP? Holy shit! But alas, he survives a goddamn black hole and is revived by some of the Wisps. If only that dedication were present in Siege lobbies.
Hey, Doc, get some ice cream?
Only a spoonful.
Only last operator standing. Mission failed. All friendlies were eliminated.
Hey, guys, subscribe for more epic Rainbow Six Siege Victory Royals!
And as an ending note, we get that orchestral theme returning and a send-off from the Wisps. Except not really, because they will appear in every title after this. The end. That's it. That's the story and setting in a nutshell. So, overall, I think it's pretty good. The dialogue is a drawback and the plot is very linear, but the setting and gameplay more than suffice for this. This is just criminally underrated, and if you haven't tried it, then please do. If Sega will ever actually re-release the game for Steam or modern consoles, that is. So, conclusion. Is Colors mediocre? No. Is it a masterpiece? No. Is it underrated? Yes, absolutely. Unleashed really seems to hog all the attention from this Redemption era, for good reasoning, but Colors was smaller scale and was infinitely more linear, so it kinda just slipped under the rug and passed off as, yeah, it's alright. But the creativity inside this box is second to none. The world is magical and really quite enjoyable to roam around in, so that's my verdict. Colors is an underappreciated gem in the series. I'm Pyro Cynical, and I do game reviews, so I'll see you soon. And for the last time, Sega brought it up!